Hey, what's up, guys? Will here for GSM Arena. Apple has revived the iPhone 8, and with a few tweaks, is being released as the iPhone SE 2020. At just $400, it may entice a lot of people to go Apple. But is it a competitive option for a mid-ranger, or just a trip down memory lane? Let's find out in our full review. A lot of phones these days look pretty similar, with their large, tall glass designs and thin bezels. The iPhone SE 2020 brings you back to a time when phones were more compact, and shrinking those bezels wasn't such a priority. It's made of Gorilla Glass with an aluminum frame, and it's super small, light, and comfortable to wield in the hand. Pretty much all of the hardware in the SE is the same as what we had in the iPhone 8, and that includes the IP67 waterproofing. The product red finish we have here is striking, and just the Apple logo itself can be enough to turn some heads. From this angle, all that separates this from the expensive models visually is the modest bump for the single camera. Flip over to the front, however, and you'll immediately see the difference from the newer iPhones. The bezels above and below the screen give you a 2014 sort of vibe. At least you won't have to worry about a cutout for the selfie cam and Face ID hardware. This is complete with a home key slash fingerprint scanner down at the bottom. In an age where many manufacturers have moved on to under-display readers, this phone takes us back to having it below the screen. The screen itself is a 4.7-inch IPS LCD with a resolution of 1334 by 750, or 326 ppi. It's sharp enough, and because of its 16:9 aspect ratio, video content fits easily on screen without stretching or black bars. Max brightness is very good too, up to 670 nits, and contrast is good, though black levels leave more to be desired. Colors are very accurate, and there's an option for true tone color correction adjustments to adapt the white point on the fly based on ambient lighting. For your audio, the iPhone SE 2020 has a pair of stereo speakers. It's a hybrid setup, with a bottom-firing loudspeaker and the earpiece acting as the second one. They're balanced enough, and loudness is very, very good. The quality is nice too, with good bass, though not quite at the level of the iPhone 11 Pro. Absolute beginners came to Georgetown. They were wearing Harris tweed and pork pie hats. The phone's interface is Apple's iOS 13.4 at the time of this video, and there should be support for 5 years of uninterrupted software updates. One of the neat new features here is a system-wide dark mode. The UI is pretty much what you'd expect from an iPhone these days, except for navigation, since you only rely on the home key and there are no swipes. Multimedia is handled through the Photos, Music, or Apple TV apps. You also get Apple's digital assistant, Siri, which is easily accessed by holding down the home key. You can assign almost anything to a shortcut accessible through Siri. Just remember that storage is finite on this device. You have options for 64, 128, or 256 gigs, and it isn't expandable. The major feature that sets the iPhone SE apart from the iPhone 8 is the new chipset. It runs on the 7-nanometer Apple A13 Bionic, the same as the premium iPhone 11 Pro. Performance is awesome, topping both the Apple and the Android charts. It blows the iPhone 8 away, and is clearly the better device for running heavy games. And it's more future-proof too. Unfortunately, the cutting-edge performance doesn't extend to the battery life. The battery's small capacity is the same as the iPhone 8's, 1,820 mAh. The iPhone SE scored an endurance rating of just 59 hours in our battery tests. It seems you can only do so much with such a small cell. You won't even be able to charge it fast either with the bundled 5-watt charger. We were only able to get from 0 to 27% in half an hour. In comparison, an 18-watt Apple charger refills about 57% of the empty battery. The benefits of upgrading to a faster charger are obvious, and while you're at it, you can grab a wireless charger since there's support for that too. Now moving on to the camera, singular here, which is a rarity these days. Even though it's the same 12-megapixel camera found on the iPhone 8, the advances in image processing are really noticeable. In daylight, the iPhone SE takes very natural-looking photos. The contrast is superb, the colors are spot-on, and noise is non-existent. Dynamic range is really wide too, thanks in part to Apple's Smart HDR. The detail levels are very good, even excellent in some spots. The phone does have some trouble with intricate details, but for this price point, the quality is superb. Portrait mode is available, and since there's just one camera, it creates the blurred background effect totally through a software-based depth map. The subject separation is far from flawless, but these are decent for not having a depth sensor. The camera's low-light performance is a big improvement over the iPhone 8, thanks to better processing. There's enough resolve detail, generally balanced exposure, and great color saturation. Dynamic range isn't the best though, and it's too bad that there's no support for night mode here to improve on that. The front-facing camera is the same 7-megapixel unit we saw on the iPhone 7 and 8, and it provides awesome quality. These are some of the best selfies we've taken recently, and they put a lot of Android phones to shame. There's outstanding detail, great contrast, and wide dynamic range. There's also support for portrait selfies, and these are pretty decent, similar separation-wise to the portraits from the main camera. Videos can be recorded with the main cam at up to 4K at 30 or 60fps. 4K video has great quality that is quite similar to that of the still images. There are great colors and contrast, wide dynamic range, and pretty good detail, except in some complex areas. There is a setting for a lower 24fps frame rate, meant to lower the shutter speed for better low-light video capture. The result is brighter than regular video at nighttime, but the quality still isn't flagship worthy. It's just fine. There is video stabilization and it works in all resolutions and frame rates, and the result is flagship level. So that's the iPhone SE 2020. It brings a compact and waterproof build, a bright and contrasty LCD screen, loud stereo speakers, outstanding chipset performance, great daylight photos, and awesome selfies. Plus you get up-to-date software support, all for just $400. So does that mean the iPhone SE is a flagship killer? Maybe, but keep in mind that a lot of things do feel outdated. The biggest offender is the battery life, which just isn't competitive these days. And the design is maybe too retro, with those big bezels eating into what could have been the screen. And what's with the missing night mode? That would help make the camera a lot more competitive in today's camera-centric market. Overall, I don't doubt that the iPhone SE will get a lot of customers. It's a good device, and the cheapest new iPhone you can buy. But from a pure value perspective, there are Android phones at this price which pack more competitive features. Thanks for watching, guys. Stay safe, and see you on the next one.